Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us this afternoon. I'm George Jackson, Vice President of Events at GovExec, and I'm excited to build on the themes of today's program with one of our underwriters, Verizon. We'll take a closer look at how they're handling the next generation of 5G networking, including something called ultra reliable, low latency communications, and more. Joining me today, Manny, Bedoya, Manager, Business Development and Technology Strategy at Verizon. Manny, good to see you, sir.
Thank you, George. I'm very happy and excited for a conversation today.
And here with him, Arsh, Director of Product Management for the Public Sector at Verizon. Arsh, hi, how you doing?
I'm doing great, thank you. I'm looking forward to our discussion today.
Me too. So I mentioned this URLLC and 5G. What is it? Why does it matter?
Well, I can start with that. So URLLC, which is ultra reliable, low latency communication, it's a part of the 3GPP standard and is one of the key elements for 5G communication. The two words here that I personally relate to a lot, and those are the performance benefits indicators, and those are number one, reliable, and number two, low latency. Reliability, as mentioned in terms of URLLC, provides ultra high network reliability with a goal of 99.999% availability of the network to support any corresponding applications. And low latency in this context refers to connecting between the devices and the network in the blink of an eye in a millisecond. So both of these terms or both of these capabilities are transformational, and they were not possible before in the previous generations of 3G and 4G technologies. 5G has it, and Verizon was the first in the world to have a 5G-enabled smartphone connected to a 5G device in 2019, and I'm super proud about that.
That's a great thumbnail. Manny, give us a couple examples. How does 5G enable what Arsh mentioned there, this ultra reliability?
Sure. So there's a couple strategies that were implemented through the standards to facilitate that kind of KPI performance that Arsh mentioned. And also in trying to bridge both the need and the requirement, not only in the public sector, but also in the manufacturing space, there's a lot of overlap with respect to these requirements. And what the network has been improved with respect to reliability comes in different types of strategies. One is having a dedicated ultra reliable low latency slice. So as Arsh mentioned, this is the very first time that the standards are really addressing this type of machine to machine communication. Up to now, the communication has been really slated for human consumption, but now we have super fast computers, super fast devices, and they have, you know, a lot less tolerance for delayed packets, right? Or missing packets. So that means that the connectivity has to be ultra reliable and that the performance has to be there. And it's a reliability story, it's a latency story, but around that, there's also a time sensitive aspect, which means that there has to be determinism, right? You need to be able to deliver the packets with predictability. All right, so that you can support these kind of use cases. Other things that they've implemented is densification of the network, where you're gonna have a lot more deployments of maybe indoor radios, let's say, and they actually coordinate the communications with the devices in the event that there's some kind of obstruction, then one device can take over. There's other things like QoS monitoring, right? So we are proactively monitoring the quality of service. There's, you know, redundant paths. And along those lines, there's a lot of technical aspects to this, but the bottom line is that a lot of these things will come together and provide wire-like reliability, wire-like latency and performance. And that's what's the really most exciting part about this.
Arsh, you mentioned latency, so did Manny. What about a couple examples there? How does 5G enable this low latency communications?
The way the 5G architecture works in general is that it's a flatter network architecture compared to 4G and the previous generations of wireless technologies. And what that does is it has offers this lower latency capabilities versus the more hierarchical network architectures that existed before. There are several scheduling algorithms that provide a more technically elegant way to prioritize traffic and how the users will actually consume the network through the applications that they have on their devices. The elements there is also the aspect of edge computing. So with MEC, which is multi-access edge computing, there is processing that is happening closer to the end user, and that's what really the lower latency offering brings into the market and how applications are working on top with this multi-access edge compute capabilities. We are also seeing this low latency, high bandwidth benefits for fixed wireless access. For example, in Verizon's fixed wireless access product portfolio, what we're doing is we're having the ability to replace the last mile of fiber with 5G for those areas in which fiber cannot be deployed. And we are able to offer internet access with high speeds when it matters the most for those customers. So it's really this whole low latency aspect comes from the way the 5G architecture is designed, which is very different from what the previous generations have seen.
Well, audience, if you're joining me late, I'm having a conversation with Manny Bedoya and Arsh Sawhney from Verizon. Let's pivot over to you, Manny. Talk a little bit about public sector in particular. That's our audience here. What kind of, use cases will URLLC enable specifically in public sector?
Thanks, George. I will probably hand this one over to Arsh, as she's the one who's primarily focused in the public sector. I'll be more than happy to comment afterwards if necessary, but I'm sure she can handle this one.
Sounds great. Okay. Arsh, jump right in there.
Absolutely. Public sector is my favorite space. That's where I spend most of my time serving our customers. And public sector, by definition, includes federal and state and local agencies, education institutions, as well as our public safety agencies like the first responders. And what URLLC and 5G is doing is it's allowing us and our customers, like the public sector agencies, to reimagine the way we are thinking and operating on a daily basis, as well as how we are responding to emergencies in those mission critical needs. There are several elements and several use cases that follow for these different segments within public sector. Specifically, if I look at artificial intelligence and machine learning at the edge of the network, that's where technologies like computer vision is coming into play for the cities. We have video analytics for security and surveillance, and that's where the high definition video capabilities for real time is being used, and 5G is a game changer when it comes to those technologies. The second thing that I'd like to mention here in terms of use cases is for the first responders. So when we have low latency, it becomes a key driver for real-time experiences. So if you look at it from a situational awareness, situational analytics perspective, our first responders need always-on mission-critical applications and technologies so that they can respond to these emergencies in the most efficient manner. For example, if a firefighter is out there helping to save somebody's life, there is a need to have real-time analysis, real-time support capabilities with thermal sensors and wearables. There has to be a good communication with the incident commanders. That's where the 5G capability for real-time really comes into play. Also on the command center side, right? When they have to dispatch resources for other emergencies, it's very important to have that connectivity across devices, across different data elements. And that's where 5G really comes into play with the low latency capability to provide that real-time experiences. An example that I'd like to take here is in the COVID-19 pandemic response, right? In very early stages, we had a city of San Jose that ran 100% on virtual emergency operations through Verizon's 5G. And that becomes a good use case as well to see how cities are adopting to respond to emergencies and to take care of the citizens and the people. Another element tied to that one is Department of Defense. The Department of Defense, we have great partnership with them across US. They are already implementing 5G and seeing how it can transform the way DoD operates today. And then I'll also look at the military bases, right? That's where a lot of transformation is needed. And that's where a lot of our early adoption of 5G is happening. The other big piece is education. There's smart campuses that are being built. And essentially what's happening in those areas is our customers are leveraging virtual reality for providing those experiential immersive learning for those advanced concepts. But most importantly, what I'm really proud of is how Verizon is serving the underserved schools, especially K through 12, with 5G deployments that we have been going on for quite some time now. And that's where we are able to provide that hands-on learning experience to the customers and to the students so that they can leverage the maximum benefit that 5G has to offer. Another use case that I can add here is on the medical side, right? There's a lot of remote augmented reality, virtual reality assisted surgeries that can be done and medical procedures and diagnostics that can happen. And that's where 5G really comes into play. And this real-time analysis is very beneficial. And then finally, I'd like to talk about venues. Public sector includes a lot of the major venues and auditoriums, the airports, the transportation hubs. So a lot of the capabilities that Verizon offers today for multi-access edge compute have tied to venue operations. And that's where a lot of the accelerated physical access, the crowd management capabilities come into play from an execution perspective to make sure we're able to take care of the operations for the customers and also the crowd or the people that are in those auditoriums and in those venues on a daily basis. So a lot of great momentum happening. I can speak to this in volumes with autonomous vehicles and many other things that are going on, but we have great collaboration today with our customers as well as partners that are helping to move this forward and really just designed the art of possible that can come with 5G in the future as well.
Manny, what an exciting portfolio. I'm just gonna summarize a little bit here. Artificial intelligence, machine learning, video analytics, first responders, smart cities, smart campuses, remote AR and VR, surgical procedures, venue operations, even autonomous vehicles. What's unique about the manufacturing sector? What stands out there as we kind of learn from your colleague about what you're doing in the public sector?
So from a manufacturing, and I would say it's actually applicable across, you know, several industries, including utilities, as you mentioned, public sector, and even enterprise. I think that the most exciting aspect of this is that for the very first time, we're able to actually reimagine processes, reimagine the way we work, because up to now, a lot of those processes had been bounded by the capabilities of the existing networks. And now we have a true opportunity with this digital transformation experience where we can actually think outside the box and provide true value. The true value from digital transformation is gonna come when you can have a holistic view of your entire operation. Deploying point solutions, of course, adds value. And there's a trajectory for an evolution for evolving towards a true ITOT, meaning operational technology and informational technology convergence. But that is really the holy grail. And that's what I get excited about, right? You have use cases that are going to exist at different spectrums, right? You're going to have some that are very latency tolerant, right? And then you're going to have others that are not so forgiven. You're going to have some that are very chattery and very small bytes, where others are gonna be on the uplink side requiring megs and megs of data. Think, for example, video surveillance. And when you overlay all this with a time-sensitive network-enabled network, which it's underpinned by URLLC, right? All of a sudden, all these things can coexist, right? And you can have a true end-to-end view and evolution of your processes in your network. And that's really when it becomes exciting. So you'll be able to have safety systems that require, you know, some, you know, millisecond type of reaction time at the same time where you're gonna have video conferencing going on the same campus, the same network, right? It's that powerful. And that is the really the value that we're trying to convey with 5G. You're gonna have built-in security. You're gonna have available services to allow it to, you know, manage and develop, you know, custom solutions where needed so that you can continue to focus on what it is that you need to provide. So a lot of exciting things, autonomous mobile robots or another. You take, for instance, transporting hazardous materials. You know, we can allow that to happen automatically with, you know, human supervision and collaboration, but you can protect the human from proximity interaction with some of, let's say, molten glass or something like that, right? You know, we have quality that's, you know, real time being inspected and decisions being made by with AI and ML to determine the quality of a particular product and what changes they need to make dynamically so that the next batch or the next unit doesn't have the same mistake. So a lot of exciting things, you know, as Verizon continues to lead, you know, in this space, we're very excited to work with several partners in this area. And we're, you know, constantly trying to innovate and figure out how do we best support and integrate this vision.
Arsh, that's a great look into Manny's crystal ball. Why don't you look into your 5G URLLC enabled crystal ball here? What does this look like in a year, 2 years, 5 years? What's state of the art?
Well, I've shared a lot about what where I see 5G going, but what I am really excited about and what I want to see happen more effectively in the future is our ability to have better incident management, more predictability and situational awareness, especially in public sector side. When our first responders are responding to these emergencies, how can we leverage data analytics? How can we leverage machine learning and augmented reality, virtual reality for better decision-making during those mission critical incidents when there are disasters? How can our first responders be powered, empowered, and get these tools in their hands with the benefits of 5G of low latency and high bandwidth to respond to these emergencies effectively, leveraging the gig per second download speeds, the less than 5 milliseconds of latencies that we see here. It's really important for us to have a much stronger response time, more stronger situational awareness in real time. And that's what I think will be one of the key areas of investments that not only Verizon, but many of our partners from an applications and the cloud service providers perspective as well will make. And we will see those transformations in multi-access edge compute type solutions, private MAC, and also private 5G. I think those will be something that I'm looking forward to seeing how transformations happen in the next year and beyond.
Well, you've heard from Arsh Sawhney, Director of Product Management, Public Sector at Verizon. Arsh, thanks for being here.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me.
And Manny Bedoya, Manager of Business Development and Technology Strategy at Verizon. Manny, thanks.
Appreciate your time. Thank you so much.
This session will be available on demand. Keep an eye on your email. Share it with your 5G-minded colleagues. For GovExec, I'm George Jackson. Have a great day.